decades, quick service restaurants have consumed the American culture of food. In this podcast, we deliver insights from founders, CEOs, and innovators on their successes and challenges. I'm Lisa Pepe. Welcome to the Fast Casual Nation.
Welcome to today's Fast Casual Nation. I'm your host, Lisa Pepe, and today we have a great, great topic. We're going to talk about how to keep your restaurant on trend while keeping up with brand identity. So we have an incredible brand. It's the second largest fast casual Mexican brand. We have Katy Velazquez, who is the executive chef for QDOBA.
Hi,
hey, Katy,
how are you?
Welcome to the show. So happy to have you.
Thank you so much for having me.
I want to jump into this. You know, QDOBA, it's a lot. There are so many locations, so I'm excited to talk to you about what you do there. I just want to remind our guests that at the end, we are going to talk to Katy about her top three tips for developing a menu, so stay tuned for that. Let's get into this, Katy. I want to know what inspired you to dive into the food service industry?
Yeah, I mean, I fell in love with food. I started working in restaurants when I was 19 as a host at a brewery, and I just fell in love with it. I grew up doing theater, and I think there's really this connection to me between theater and restaurants. There's this feeling of like getting ready and preparation, and right before the show goes on, and then the guests come in, and it's camera, and it's lights, and it's you know, sort of the facade and the theater part of it. And it just sort of feels really similar. And I absolutely love it.
Well, and there's also that excitement. It's like before the show goes on, it's like the equivalent of, you know, before the customers taste or bite into something that you've created, and that look of satisfaction on their face when they really enjoy it. It's like probably a little similar, correct?
Of course, it's like that instant gratification of, do they Yes. love what I'm doing for them?
Yes, I love it. But, you know, I want to know, before we take a deep dive in what you're currently doing at QDOBA, I want to know, tell me what your career looked like before you joined the brand.
Absolutely. Shortly after I finished culinary school, I got a job working for Chef Rick Bayless in Chicago, and it completely changed the trajectory of my entire career. For him, I got the opportunity to write a cookbook with him and travel all over Mexico while we were filming his PBS show, and I got to do what I consider my sort of PhD in regional Mexican cuisine. And I just fell in love with Mexican food and the culture and the way they feed people. And it's really, I've been in Mexican food ever since then.
Wow, that's great. I didn't know that about you. I love when you could share stories like that. You know, so it's all about, I would say, I read that QDOBA prides itself on flavors. You know, and I want to know, as the executive chef, how can you stay up with that? How do you make sure that you're providing super true flavors, authenticity, I would assume, to what's familiar within Mexican, but still trying to like hit it out of the park a little bit? You know what I'm saying?
Of course. I mean, I think for us, we're always looking for what we internally call flavor differentiators. So these are things that nobody else in the market is going to be having. And I think about my time in Mexico, where you're, you know, eating tacos at all of these little street stands, right? And I've done a couple of these trips where I've just eaten at like 12 of them in a row. And
Kate, if you need somebody on one of those next trips, when you're going around eating tacos, sign me up, please. I'll be happy to follow you and write about it. Yeah, I'm in on eating tacos until I can't see straight. Anyway, that's it. I digress.
Yep.
Go ahead. Sorry about that.
Absolutely. No, I was just going to say, you after you're eating them taco after taco, they all tend to blend together. But the thing that you remember are these incredible homemade salsas. And to the naked eye, they might look the same, like, oh, they've got a green and a red. But it's those flavors. Yeah. That's the thing that sort of sings and that you remember. And so as we're creating burritos and and bowls and nachos and things like that at QDOBA. We want to have these extra special sauces and toppings that are the things that you're really going to remember when you think about QDOBA.
Yeah, no, that's a great point, and I'm a true believer. I think the more sauces, the better, along with as many tacos as possible. So, I want to talk to me about your thought process behind refreshing a traditional Mexican menu or food flavors. How do you take that on to keep bringing something new but keeping tradition?
Yeah, I think it's sort of a combination of two things. It's a combination of sort of finding flavors that are rooted in authentic Mexican cuisine, but then combining it with sort of modern American trendy flavors. So for us, a great example is we recently launched brisket birria. And birria is a super trendy flavor that is really popular in LA right now. It comes from Jalisco. It's very authentic to Mexico. We kind of put our own spin on it by using a premium cut like brisket. But that's a really great way sort of to combine the two. Another great example is our citrus lime shrimp that we just launched. The flavors are reminiscent of a sour orange, like naranja agria sauce from Yucatan. But we are bringing these delicious flavors to our customer so they can use it on their entrees.
Oh. Sounds delicious. What new trends are we going to see on QDOBA's menu? Anything coming up through 2023 that we could start talking about? Give us the inside scoop, maybe?
Nothing that I can totally talk about yet, but I can hint to the fact that we are going to be relaunching a QDOBA fan favorite that we're going to be bringing back to the menu. And the other thing is that we've, like I mentioned, we recently relaunched our shrimp, and it's here through April, and it's going to be a huge success for us. We absolutely love this product, and our customers love this product. And then our brisket birria that we launched as an LTO is actually going to be staying permanently on the menu. Our fans loved it so much that it is now a permanent fixture on the QDOBA menu.
That's great to hear. So you're able to launch a LTO limited time offer, and if it does extremely well with the brand or customers are loving it, I love that you put it into the regular menu. That's great. And how often do you guys launch LTOs?
You know, we launch 2 to 4 a year, I would say, depending on the year and depending on what else is happening in the organization. But that's sort of our target.
With launching the 2 to 4 in the past 2 years, we talk about supply chain. Did you have to get creative with the recipes during that time due to shortage of ingredients that you might have used for some limited time offer?
Absolutely. But I think some of those constraints tend to make you work the hardest and be the most creative. I think a great example of that is our Cholula hot and sweet chicken that we launched in 2020 in COVID. There was no way that we were bringing in new product for an LTO. We created this incredible, delicious, craveable, sweet and spicy sauce that we would add to our existing chicken, and it completely transformed our chicken. So it was simple from an operational execution, and it was simple on a supply chain standpoint, and it was launched as an LTO, and it has stayed on our menu for years now because our customers love it so much. So absolutely, I would say sometimes the hardest things create the most beautiful products at the end.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more with that. Do you, and that also goes to your dedication to being a chef and really transforming these items, turning them into something special on the menu. But speaking of menu, I want to know, do you have a favorite menu item? Can you name one? Is there a handful?
I mean, the honest truth is that my favorite is always the next one that's about to be launched that no one knows about yet. Yeah. That I've been working on. But no, we've got two ingredients that I truly love. And anytime I'm making my own lunch, I'm putting them on there. We've got our chili crema, which is this smoky, creamy sauce. And then we've got our pickled red onions that just, I add on everything, and they're bright and they're beautiful and visual, and they are super limey that we add our real lime juice to them. They're just super flavorful, and I love them.
That's great. I have to ask this. I believe it's more than 730 locations across the US and Canada. That is to get the recipes done and then get them consistently being delivered to your customers across the board. It could not be easy. I wonder if there's something that you could share for those tuning in that are thinking about becoming an executive chef for a super giant, large chain. Is there some type of advice you could offer? Or was there advice maybe that someone had given you or didn't give you that you wish you knew going into this?
Well, I think in terms of creating recipes that are scalable and easy to execute across 730 locations, I think testing is the most important thing. I think just test, whether that's internally in your test kitchen, make the recipe a million times, have other people make the recipe just to make sure you're doing it right. But I would say in terms of creating new products, I think you don't want to underestimate your customer. I think the customer is becoming more and more educated every single day. There's TV shows on Netflix now, Taco Chronicles, and all of the Top Chef shows. And people are really passionate about food, and they know a lot. They're well-traveled. And so I think, a number of years ago, what people thought Mexican cuisine was probably here, and it's really expanding. Sure. So I think it's great for someone in my position, and that it gives us room to play and to try new things.
That's great advice, great tips there. I want to know, if you had to give other restaurant executives some advice about keeping the menu items, fresh and appealing, what would that advice be?
I would first say, think holistically about your menu. So, there is a limit to how many sauces you need. You don't need 30. You can focus on some of the other menu gaps on your menu. I would say also think about the experience that a diner is going to have. I am constantly going out and eating things, and I'm like, I just need texture. I'm eating a bowl of mush. And I think you think back to some of your favorite meals that you've ever had, I guarantee you there's going to be a variety of textural experiences on that entree. So definitely think about texture and the customer's sort of eating experience. And then last, I just think about how you would feed people in your own home. Some of my favorite meals that I've ever had as I've traveled in Mexico have been the ones that taste like someone's mom cooked them. They've not been the tweezer, super fine dining meals. They're the ones that feel comforting and homey and like somebody wants to take care of you as they're feeding you.
Yeah, no, that's great. So if we boil it down to my last question here, which is, give us your best three tips, Katy, on developing a menu.
Yeah, I would say think holistically. I would say think about experience and texture. And then think about feeding people the way you would if you were inviting them over to your home.
Yeah, those are excellent. Katy, I'm so happy we got to have this time with you today. I feel like, every time we can share how we're doing things successfully, it helps the next person out in the same position. So thank you for coming by the show today. I wish you all the best. I'm going to be on the lookout for your new LTOs. Absolutely. And thanks again.
Thank you so much for having me.
I wanted to thank you guys for tuning in today. You know, I think you should absolutely go ahead and hit the subscribe button if you're over there on YouTube and give us a review. Tell us what you like. Tell us who you want to see on the show. You can also get some great chef ratings over on Chef AF at Substack. Be sure to check that out. I'm your host, Lisa Pepe. This is Fast Casual Nation, and I'll check you next time.